Good afternoon. Welcome to Zane and his parish. This afternoon we celebrate the 23rd Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our celebrant this evening is the pastor of Zane and his parish, Father Chris Kaufman. As an opening hymn with Mary, we sing, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy burdened on this Labor Day."
Graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, "You, son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. If I tell the wicked, 'O wicked one, you shall surely die,' and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt, but I will hold you responsible for his death. But if you warn the wicked, trying to turn him from his way, and he refuses to turn from his way, he shall die for his guilt, but you shall save yourself." The word of the Lord. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Come, let us sing joyfully to the Lord. Let us acclaim the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us joyfully sing songs to him.
If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord who made us. For he is our God, and we are the people he shepherds, the flock he guides.
If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Oh, that today you would hear his voice. Harden not your hearts as in Meribah, as in the day of Massa in the desert, where your fathers tempted me. They tested me, though they had seen my works. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandment there may be, are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no evil to the neighbor. Hence, love is the fulfillment of the law. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every fact may be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. Amen, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are to pray, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. The Gospel of the Lord. Sin, and they're wanting some way to restore what is lost. when we show someone that we care about more than just that surface level program responses, that we really care for their well-being and want to be there for it as a strong support, they're freer to be much more vulnerable about what's really going on. And when we open up that conversation, we can talk openly and honestly about the sin in our life and those other spiritual roadblocks. We can then address it and invite them to take advantage of the remedies that Christ offers through his church in the sacraments of confession, the Eucharist. You know, the scriptures remind us today that the motive for reaching out to others and trying to bring them back from sin is love. And love is the motive for taking someone aside and calling to their attention what we see to be the sins that they may not recognize in their life. And I think as we think about that, it can be a quite frightening responsibility for us, because bringing a person's sins to their attention can be perceived as being judgmental, critical. And that's certainly not how we want to convey Jesus' grace. We just want to bring the darkness out into the light so healing can take place. You know, St. Paul says today, love does no evil to the neighbor. Meaning that as we confront this conversation, it must be done with gentleness and sincerity, not with harshness, not with condemnation. But still, I think we question, how do we do that when people are primed already to become quite defensive about their faults? Well, I think it requires us to foster a real sense of trust in one another. Because if I trust that you truly love me, that you truly have my genuine good in mind, not just that you're trying to control me or advance your own agenda, then I'll listen to you. Then I'll be open to you. You know, I think we only have to take a cue from Jesus in so many stories when he confronts people with the reality of their sin. Perhaps one of the best examples is the story of a woman caught in adultery in the Gospel of John. And truly, she had sinned greatly in the eyes of God, and she was ashamed of it. She knew she deserved the just punishment for her sin. But Jesus came to her as the crowds were ready to stone her, and he forced her accusers to walk away one by one as he called them to acknowledge their own sin. And then as the woman laid at Jesus' feet and asked if anyone there stood condemning her, she looked up and she said, "No one, sir." And then Jesus, in his infinite love for her soul, picked her up from the dust and he said, "Then neither do I condemn you." But it's interesting, you know, at the same time it was clear, you know, not to just give her a pass, not to just give her permission to keep sinning. He said, "Yes, your sins are forgiven, but go and sin no more." You know, I think that woman likely became one of Jesus' most faithful disciples. Because I think it was in that encounter that she came to know that Jesus is the one that truly loves her very soul. And I think when we look at such stories, it's those who are able to recognize Jesus' love for them that are then able to accept the hard truth of their sinfulness. Without arguing, without debating, without making excuses, but humbly opening themselves up to the truth and to the remedy that Christ offers. On the other hand, it was the hardness of heart of Jesus' enemies that caused them to take the wrong way time and time again, who refused to recognize Jesus' love for them, who didn't want to think that they were imperfect in any way, so they weren't open to correction. You know, we are meant to be used by God for his purpose, to allow his love to penetrate through the cracks of the human heart and touch their soul with the reality of their sin and the reality of God's healing mercy. And I think that's why it's so important, you know, to do this with gentleness and sincerity. Again, not with harshness or condemnation that can turn people away from Christ. You know, souls are searching. They're searching for someone who really cares, someone who's genuine in their love for them. They're wanting to see the love of Jesus for them, because so many are struggling, whether it's some sin of theirs or some other spiritual obstacle. And And this is where we can be used. We need to put on the mind of Christ, take up the mission of his church, which is the love of souls and their eternal salvation. And particularly in your day-to-day life, you know, that one soul that stands before you, whether it's your spouse or your child or your parent or your friend. You know, one of the most important conversations you can have to them, with them when we truly mean it is to truly ask them, how is your soul? Now, this is the church's purpose when teaching on any moral issue. You know, even those that many people oppose these days. It's not, you know, basically to get everyone to conform to the way the church wants things to be, but rather it's because the church is very aware of how these issues can affect the soul. And so the church goes out in its mission to not impose, but rather propose the truth. So when the church teaches against contraception, against abortion, it's not about winning a political argument. In fact, the church rightly acknowledges that a person has the free will to choose right or to choose wrong. But out of love for that person, and for the sake of their soul, the church wants them to make the right choice, the choice that Christ would have them make. And that is the way of your consideration. You know, preventing a life from being conceived in an act of marital love, or taking a child's life in the womb endangers a person's eternal soul. When the church encourages chastity and sexual purity outside of marriage, and true fidelity within marriage, again, it's looking to the good of the soul. The eternal consequences for an unrepentant soul who engages in such sin are far greater than any brief pleasure one may gain from a moment of passion. When the church teaches that we should not receive Holy Communion, if we're conscious of serious sin that we have not yet confessed, yet again, the church is concerned for the person's soul, wanting people to receive Jesus worthily so that they might gain the benefit of grace, which were prevented from receiving mortal sins present. And so it is with any sin in our life. The church wants us to be free of all of that burden, so that our eternity is assured and that we have a life free from the weight and the burden of sin. That truly free and truly happy life. You know, the truth is, you know, each and every one of us, we all have our spiritual burdens that we carry. And we all struggle with some attachment to sin, whether great or small. And perhaps, you know, in the course of your years, maybe a loved one has pulled you aside and point out one or two to you. Maybe you refuse to listen. Perhaps you've tried to get a loved one yourself to turn from their sin, and they resist it. But you know, Jesus says, keep trying, but do it out of love. Because he gives us a simple remedy. If only we'll be open to it. He established it for us out of love for us. To come to him. To fall at his free feet. Through the humble confession of our sins and the sacrament of reconciliation. To help us find a way back to God. So today it's an invitation to begin to look into your heart as I ask you out of love. How is your relationship with God? And how is your soul?
bishops, all priests and deacons, for all who hold and teach the Catholic faith. May they be instruments of Christ's unity and peace through their preaching and example. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to abortion, euthanasia, and other practices that threaten the dignity and sanctity of human life. That we may recognize and defend the value of every life, from conception to natural death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a swift end to the current pandemic, and for continued safety and health of all in our St. Anne's parish and school communities, in our community of the Soar, and throughout our nation and world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all workers on this Labor Day weekend, may they never labor in vain, but with the knowledge that in putting their God-given gifts at the service of others, they build up the kingdom of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For further growth in our relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, for a deeper experience of His grace through a spirit of fervent prayer, deepening conversion, and frequent reception of the sacraments, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of all the faithful departed, especially John and Meg Skelly, may they know the mercy of Christ and rise with Him to new and eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty, eternal Father, we turn to You in humble, confident faith that You hear and answer all of our prayers. Accept all these needs that we lay at Your feet this day and answer them all in accord with Your most holy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Set humanity over the whole world and all its through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Anne, and with all the saints. On his constant intercession in your presence, we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our bishop, his assistant Andrew, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you in their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. Savior's command, informed by the divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass.
distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, power, and the glory of yours, and all is forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. To receive Jesus Christ in the most holy Eucharist today, let us reflect upon and contemplate Christ's presence among us as he offers himself to us as strength and a source of healing for our sins. Let us take a moment to express our deep desire to be united to him in ever deeper ways. Lord Jesus Christ, I believe that you are in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
This weekend, as you may recall, we will be taking up special collection for disaster relief following the explosion in Lebanon earlier this month. If you would like to give, you can place a gift. There's a special box by the main door of the church today. You can also place any clearly marked donation in any of the baskets at the door of the church. Please make checks out to St. Anne's Parish. You can mark your donation clearly for the Lebanon collection. You may also mail or drop off something at the Parish Center if that's more convenient for you. Thank you for your generosity. I received a great response from those interested in joining our RCIA classes this year in order to receive their sacraments. I'll be working in the next few days to put together a schedule of classes that works best for our participants so we can get started hopefully by the end of the month. If you are thinking of joining but are still interested in doing so but missed the deadline this last Friday, you can still join. Just please feel free to contact me at the parish office by phone or email with any questions or to sign up. Please note that next month, the month of October, is St. Anne's opportunity to cover the Sewer food shelf. If you'd like to help or would like more information on volunteering, we ask that you contact Mary Beth Feeney. Today, as of tomorrow, we're only 2 weeks away from our Applefest celebration, which will take place on Sunday, September 20th. We're planning, hopefully, the weather will be nice enough to offer an outdoor mass. There will be a great hog roast dinner that you can take out or receive in delivery. There will be cash raffles, silent auction items, painted pumpkins, and a wine pool. We are still in need of some silent auction items for our adapted auction this year, which will take place online through a special Applefest Facebook page. Just as in previous years, any items that you think would make a nice basket or a nice gift will be accepted. Just drop those off at the parish office anytime in the coming days. And then finally, I believe after Mass today and this weekend, you'll have the opportunity to purchase raffle and dinner tickets for Applefest just outside the door of the church in the parking lot. Raffle tickets are a chance to win. One of the cash raffles are $30 a piece. TV raffle tickets are $5 a piece. And hog roast dinner tickets are $12 for adults and $5 for children 10 and under. Tickets may also be purchased at the parish office. And then finally, I'd like to wish you all a very happy Labor Day weekend, however you're spending it. I believe this is considered the official end of the summer, though we hope we still get some nice weather in the days to come. But we do ask the Blessed Mother's intercession for us, for all workers throughout our nation, especially in our own community, and that through her help, through her prayers, they may be protected and kept safe as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace.